Alleluia Ministries International is a Bible-believing and Christ-centered church. We believe Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. His power is still at work in the church today, just as it was in the time of the Bible. We are AMI.
You must know that the blessings of God are made available to every child of God. But to access that which was made available, you are expected to do according to the scriptures. Are we all called to be blessed? Yes. Did he bless us all? Yes. But to access it, he has given us a map. In this world, everything you need for your deliverance is found.
I receive.
But the difficulty in going through the word of God is he has coded his word that you can read it and recite it and still not grab it. You need to be enlightened by revelation. That's why those who walk in the spirit do not fulfill the works of the flesh, because they walk in revelation.
This is a presentation of Alleluia Ministries International.
I want to today speak a little more about the altar, just a little more, to keep you in the mind and the spirit of the altar. I want you to close your eyes and lift your hands. Allow the Spirit of God to prepare you, to prepare your heart. Now you are watching us from around the world. As the Lord will speak from this altar, I want you to know that he has you in mind, meaning this word is your word. Whatever announcement given here, God gave it knowing that you will be connected. Do not let it pass. Right now, I plead with you, prepare your heart that God may speak to your heart. Today is a day not like others. Today, God will visit his people. Sons and daughters of God will experience the power of God. This is the day of the Lord. In the day of the Lord, whatever title you will lay on it, it works. You may say today is a day of healing, a day of deliverance, a day of breakthrough, Amen. A day of prosperity, a day of testimony.
Amen.
Whatever it is, this is the day of the Lord.
I have a feeling.
That God today, as he speaks to us, he will turn somebody's mourning into dancing.
I receive it.
He has anointed me this morning to stand with you. He has anointed me, equipped me to hold you. So that together we may test that the Lord is good.
Amen.
Today is your day of breakthrough.
Amen.
Your day of healing and deliverance.
I receive it.
A day that the door that the enemy had locked will break open.
I receive.
A day not like others. Prepare your spirit. Prepare your spirit. Ramamama Zonto. Makoko Bobo Boshea. Lord, prepare me, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, prepare. To be a sanctuary, pure and holy, right and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be here.
Prepare me, O God.
We thanksgiving.
I Lord, I pray, prepare us. Prepare us for your word. Bless each one of us, Lord, today.
Yes, Jesus.
May this word, oh God, impact our lives.
In the name of Jesus.
It is in the name, precious name of our Lord Jesus that we have prayed. Amen. Together we say amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Well, quickly read with me from the first book of Samuel, chapter 1, verse 8 to 18. At the count of 3, 1, 2, and 3, then Elkanah, her husband, said to her, amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Well, this morning I share with you the word of God titled The Guardian of the Altar. Allow me to inform you that there is no altar without a guardian.
Amen.
The guardian of the altar. The text we have read this morning is to align us and put that in the context of this very thought. Many of us have read this portion of the scriptures again and again, but now I want you to read it and conceive it with a new understanding, the understanding of the guardian of the altar. Now, if we're speaking about the guardian of the altar, I am moving the focus away from the one we have all grown to love, Anna, the mother of Samuel. And I am laying the focus solely on Eli. Some people call him Eli, whatever the case may be. The guardian of the altar. As you are led by God to raise an altar, you must understand that God will expect you to be guardian of that altar. Verse 8 of the first book of Samuel, chapter 1, as we read, the Bible said, then Elkanah, her husband, said to her, Anna, why do you weep? Why do you not eat? And why is your heart grieved? Am I not better to you then 10 sons? So Anna arose after they had finished eating and drinking in Silo. Now Eli, the priest, was sitting on the seat by the doorpost of the tabernacle of the Lord. And she was in bitterness of soul and prayed to the Lord and wept in anguish. Then she made a vow and said, O Lord of hosts, if you will indeed look on the affliction of your maidservant and remember me, and not forget your maidservant, but will give your maidservant a male child, then I will give him to the Lord all the days of his life, and no razor shall come upon his head. Simply meaning that I will commit him to be a Nazarite. And it happened as she continued praying before the Lord that Eli watched her mouth. Now Anna spoke in her heart, only her lips moved, but her voice was not heard. Therefore Eli thought she was drunk. So Eli said to her, how long will you be drunk? Put your wine away from you. But Anna answered and said, no, my Lord, I am a woman of sorrowful spirit. I have drunk neither wine nor intoxicated drink, but I have poured out my soul before the Lord. Do not consider your maidservant a wicked woman, for out of the abundance of my complaint and grief, I have spoken until now. Then Eli answered and said, go in peace, and the God of Israel grant your petition, which you have asked of him. And she said, let your maidservant find favor in your sight. So the woman went away and ate and their face was no longer sad. Now this is a remarkable story of a woman who was sorrowful. She was sorrowful not because she did not have a good marriage. She was sorrowful because in her marriage she lacked something she dearly wanted. She wanted a child and she could not have a child. And because of that, she was sorrowful. The husband, Elkanah, loved her. But despite the love, the man went on and married a second wife, Penina. Penina had children, the Bible says, but Anna did not have children. She was in pain and she wanted to have a child. Now, the need that she had may not be exactly the need that you have. But wherever you are, you too have something you are trusting God for. You have something you are saying, oh God, I do not feel complete unless I have this. Please give it to me. Anna was sorrowful and decided to go in the presence of God. Now going to the presence of God in her time was literally locked to being in touch with the altar. Thank God for Jesus Christ. You can pray wherever you are. You can call on God literally everywhere. But the power of the altar that was literally effective yesterday is as well effective today. Mm-hmm. She could have prayed at home, but no. The Bible says she went to the altar and prayed. And there she prayed. She made a vow. She vowed to God. There are a few things that if you see somebody entering into that level, you must know. It does not depend on time and circumstances anymore. Manifestation will be seen.
I receive it.
When you understand the power of a vow, you must know something will manifest. So right there in the presence of God, this woman, sorrowful woman, cried before God. I have taught you and say she travailed before God. She agonizomied. She worked. She was like a woman in labor. She was going through labor pain. She prayed and prayed. You know, there are times where you come in the house of God and you pray. You're really not praying to God. You're praying to impress the person next to you. You're checking your vocabulary. You're checking your English. And if you are a VVS, very, very spiritual, you try to influence or to shake the person by throwing a bit of Hebrews in your prayer time. You call Jehovah Sabaoth. And you are saying it not really because you believe in anything that is Sabaoth, but you heard that word and you're trying to influence the understanding or the person next to you to believe more in you. You are Jehovah Sabaoth. You're throwing it to him. Come to church and you realize what happens in church. It is a funny community. Not everybody comes for Jesus. Some people come to show their shoes.
Right.
They come to show their watch. And when they are praying, right, they're not lifting their hands to Jesus. They're putting it in front of you.
Right.
You gotta feel me today.
Jesus.
It's a funny community. We all come to the house of God drawn by many things. Some people come for Jesus, but others come for other people. They come to meet new friends. They say that those in church behave, so you come to get one from church. Others come not because of anybody else. They come for themselves. They take 2 hours fixing their hair. When they come with that hair, they shake it as if it's really the hair.
Hey.
We all know where you took it from.
Don't be jealous now.
But anyway, be it you bought it downtown or you grew it yourself, it is yours. The devil is a liar. Keep on shaking it. But you see, you gotta at least be cool and understand that when you come to the house of God, it has to be for God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
You see, the reason why sometimes we try to get too involved on other people's business in the house of God is because we have come with no plan. We have come just to come. We are there just to be. But there are people here who have not come to check who is present or absent. They have come because they want to touch heaven. They have come because they have an issue. They have come because they say, oh God, today, tomorrow is too far.
Oh,
show
Lord.
Up in my life. I cannot take it anymore. I have nobody else. You are my Alpha. You are my Omega. I need you more than I need anything. I need you more than the breath of life itself. There are men and women who have come here not to play cheeky-cheeky.
Oh, no.
They have not come to impress you. They have not come for the best seat. They have come for Jesus.
Jesus.
Can I see the hand of those who have come for Jesus?
Jesus.
Judge me as you want. I am not here for you.
Yeah.
I am here for Jesus.
Jesus.
Now, please, I have a seat. The Bible says, this woman was sorrowful. She was in the presence of God. I cannot do without you. Cannot do without you. I cannot do without you. Oh, Lord. This may be you. You are saying, I cannot do without you. I need you today. I need you tomorrow. The doctors have given up on me. My family have turned their back on me. My friends became my enemies. I have no one else. No one to look to. I cannot do without you. If it is you, I want you to know Jehovah God has his eyes on you. He's a story changer. He's a way maker. He's about to do something in your life. Those who look to him are radiant. Their faces will never be covered with shame.
Oh, Lord.
Hear this. And I came. Had nobody else. No one to understand. No one to run to. But God. Though Elkanah spoke good. But his action were not good. Because if he meant completely what he said, he would have not gone to Penina. Do something new, Lord. And I say, I am tired of the old. I need you to do something new, oh God. Something new. Change my story. Turn my shame to fame. Oh Lord.
Change it, oh God.
Do something new.
Please, Lord.
I pray something new,
yes,
in my life.
Something new in my life.
You are saying, oh God, do something new in my life. The Lord our God created your ears. He hears. He said, call on me and I will answer you. If you call on him, he will answer you.
Be sure to tune in next time for the continuation of this preaching.
You gotta understand that your way out is Jesus.
Amen.
It's no neighbor, it's no colleague, it's no comrade, it is Jesus. Sometimes it is okay to fight inside and keep cool outside.
If you were blessed by this video, be sure to subscribe to our channel You can catch Pastor Alph Lukau on AMI TV on the public bouquet or on our live stream on amitv.com. You can follow Pastor Alph Lukau on all social media platforms at Alph Lukau.